afternoon to the Jack P. Lewis Lectures for 2013. This is now the third year that we've had these lectures, and they are named in honor of one of the great teachers and scholars in Churches of Christ, Jack P. Lewis, who has taught for a number of decades at the Harding Graduate, well, let me get it right, Harding School of Theology, as it is now. And we named these lectures in his honor because we thought he epitomized both scholarship and ministry, care for ministers in a university academic context. And that's what we wanted to honor and seek to emulate as well here at Heritage. We are honored this year to have Everett Ferguson as our Jack P. Lewis lecturer. Let me quickly run down the schedule and then I'll tell you a little more about Dr. Ferguson. After this lecture, which will be about 45 minutes or an hour total length in time, we will then move over into the other building. And those of you who would like to stay for the 5 o'clock session are welcomed. We will have dinner. And during that session, there will be a few different speakers, including one of our graduate students, Will Tidwell, who is here, will give a brief report about some of the research he is doing. But also during that time, Dr. Ferguson will have an opportunity to talk a little bit about his own biography, how he developed in both his ministerial context and his academic context. And we will be able to ask questions during that time, briefly, because we will then come back into this room at 6:30 for his second lecture. You are here because you have heard and been blessed by the work of Dr. Ferguson in the past. So I know that I don't need to say much about him to introduce him to you, because you are familiar with him. He has, of course, taught church history at Abilene Christian University for a number of decades, again, and retiring in 1998. And during that time, he has certainly not slowed down at all, but has focused on research and has produced a number of significant works. You are familiar with some of his writings, I know. One of the things that I have been impressed with Dr. Ferguson concerning is that he has been able, in a broad context, to address issues that have particular interest for people in the Churches of Christ. And so he has published just 3 years ago, 4 years ago, I guess now, a massive book on baptism that is the standard work on baptism in the first 5 centuries of the church. Besides that, he's also published a book called, it's actually called, The Church of Christ. And it's published by Erdmann's, and it appeals to a broad group of people as a book about what the New Testament teaches about the church. But just the fact that he's able to publish a book called The Church of Christ, not with a publisher affiliated with us, but with a broad academic publisher, is quite impressive. He has a well-known book called Backgrounds of Early Christianity that I'm sure some of you have used, and I have required that in a, as a course textbook in some of my courses here. And then one book I want to point your attention to that will probably be a blessing to you, and the reason I want to point your attention to it is there are some copies for sale in the back, is his book Acapella Music in the Public Worship of the Church. Which is probably the best book you'll get arguing in favor of a cappella music in our worship as Christians. I read this book as an undergraduate and it blessed me. It has, you've probably read this book before, probably in an earlier edition, because the 4th edition has just come out and that is the edition that is for sale for $7 in the back. If you would like that, I'm sure Dr. Ferguson would be willing to sign his name to your copy. So Dr. Ferguson has done a lot of work. He has blessed a lot of people with his scholarship, with his teaching. We are also blessed to have his wife Nancy here with us, who is in the back. And on a personal note, I'll say that I remember just a couple of years ago, not quite 2 years ago, I guess, I was sitting in my office and an email came from Everett Ferguson. There was upcoming a conference in Chicago called the North American Patristics Society Annual Meeting. And I was going to be delivering a paper there, and I think Dr. Ferguson was also delivering a paper there, and he emailed me and he said, "I saw your name on the program. I was wondering if you wanted to room with me." And I remember heading over, just sort of in awe of that.
Wow.
And heading over to my colleague Nathan Davies' office and said, "Everett Ferguson just asked me to room with him at a conference. Now I know that I've made it."
Wow.
So you know my name is a Scottish name. So make the association on Price.
Yeah.
Sorry to deflate you.
Well, yeah. Nevertheless, it was such an honor. Even though I was just a cheaper room.
I thought maybe Gallagher meant to be expensive.
But so for me personally, he's been a blessing. I've enjoyed getting to know him and his wife over the past, not quite 24 hours since they've been with us. It has been a blessing, and we are looking forward to hearing his talk at this time on periodizations of history in early Christianity, Dr. Everett Ferguson.
Thank you, Ed. You have been a gracious and very helpful host to my wife and me while we're here. Our topic for this lecture is Periodizations of History by Patristic Authors. In 1964, Auguste Luneau published the major study of this topic in French. The English translation is The History of Salvation According to the Fathers of the Church, The Doctrine of the Ages of the World. So now, almost 50 years later, perhaps it is time to take another look at divisions of history according to early Christian writers. Nevertheless, I will take Luneau's study as my point of departure, offering a different arrangement of the sources, making some refinements, and at one point presenting a corrective. One common periodization was into six or seven eras. I grouped them together because they both come out of the same framework of ideas. Speculation on the 6 days of creation in Genesis 1, and a thousand years in your sight are as a day, Psalms 90 verse 4, led to a division of six periods totaling 6,000 years between creation and the return of Christ. An early representative of this view was the author of the Epistle of Barnabas, not the New Testament Barnabas. He wrote, "Something has been written about the Sabbath in the Ten Commandments. This refers to the Sabbath at the beginning of creation. Observe, my children, what it says. He brought it to completion in 6 days. This means that in 6,000 years, the Lord will bring to completion all things. For a day with him signifies 1,000 years. Therefore, my children, all things will be brought to completion in 6 days, that is, 6,000 years. And he rested on the seventh day. This means that when his son comes, he will abolish the time of the lawless one, will judge the godless, and will change the sun, moon, and stars. Then truly he will rest on the seventh day." The author only specifies the length of time the world will exist before the second coming of Christ for judgment, and does not delineate the 6,000 years into six ages. The division of history into six or seven periods likely came from Jewish apocalyptic literature, but the connection is tenuous. The surviving Ethiopic text of 1 Enoch describes a sequence of 7 weeks. However, there has been a displacement in the text for earlier, 2 chapters before that, there are an 8th, 9th, and 10th week, in the last of which shall be judgment, the appearance of a new heaven, and many weeks without number forever, a time of goodness and righteousness, and sin shall no more be heard of. So actually there are 10 periods in this text. The Jewish Sibylline Oracles has 7 generations, after which a Christian redactor inserted the coming of the incarnate Son of God. Presumably, an 8th and 9th generation were omitted by the Christian redactor, for the next book of the Sibylline Oracles seems to us to resume the count by referring to the 10th generation. In what is likely a Christian reworking of the long ascension of 2nd Enoch, there is an understanding of the duration of time as 7,000 years, in contrast to an unending 8,000. The interpretation incorporated an identification of the 8th day as the first day of the week that was used by clearly Christian authors. And I quote from 2nd Enoch, "On the 8th day I likewise appointed, so that the 8th day might be the first created of my week, and that it should revolve in the revolution of 7,000, so that the 8,000 might be in the beginning of a time not reckoned and unending, neither years nor months nor weeks nor days nor hours, like the first day of the week, so also that the 8th day of the week might return continually." Well, if the thinking reflected in this passage was not the product of Christian understanding, that originated earlier, it could provide the framework for the speculations of Barnabas. On the other hand, the idea that the world would last for 6,000 years is found in rabbinic literature. The Babylonian Talmud tractate on the Sanhedrin contains some of these speculations. One of these, citing Psalms 90 verse 4, divides the history of the 6,000 years the world will exist into 2,000 years of desolation before the Torah, 2,000 years of Torah, and 2,000 years of the Messiah, but delayed because of the sins of the people. Another suggests that the 6,000 years is followed by the world being desolate for the 7,000. Yet another is that there are 7 periods at the end of which the Son of David, the Messiah, will come. Returning to Christian authors, I note that Hippolytus, like Barnabas, accepted the idea that since in 6 days God made all things, it follows that 6,000 years must be fulfilled, or a day with the Lord is as 1,000 years. Hippolytus went further to calculate that the first appearance of our Lord in the flesh took place in Bethlehem under Augustus in the year 5,500 of the world, and he suffered in the 33rd year. The Roman Empire will rule for 500 years, after which the Antichrist will appear and make war against the saints. Then we may expect the manifestation of the Lord from heaven. In this scheme, the Sabbath is the type and emblem of the future kingdom of the saints, when they shall reign with Christ, when he comes from heaven, as John says in his Apocalypse. Hippolytus's concern was to alleviate anxiety about an imminent end of the world. On his calculations, since he lived about 200 years after the coming of Christ, some 300 years remained before the end of time. Both Barnabas and Hippolytus have been classified as Kilius or millennialists on the assumption that the seventh day for them was a millennial kingdom on earth. But this is to impose on them a scheme that they do not expressly state. I have argued elsewhere that Barnabas collapses the seventh day into his eighth day. The passage we read at the beginning continues after quoting Isaiah 1 verse 13. You see how God says that the present Sabbaths are not acceptable to me, but the one I have made, in which I will give rest to all things and make a beginning of an eighth day, which is the beginning of another world. Wherefore, we Christians keep the eighth day, equals the first day, for joy, not the seventh day as the Jews did, on which Jesus also arose from the dead and when he appeared ascended into heaven. Since the seventh day for Barnabas is actually the eighth day, there is no interim millennial kingdom before the new world in which the sun, moon, and stars are changed and God's people share God's rest. More expressly for Hippolytus, when the last kingdom, that of Rome, is removed, then earthly things cease, then heavenly things begin, in order that the indestructible and eternal kingdom of the saints might be made manifest. The kingship given to the Son of Man is neither temporary nor earthly. Thus, the words of Hippolytus clearly disavow an earthly millennial kingdom. Such is not the case with Irenaeus, who explicitly gives a Kilist or millennial understanding to the creation week, giving a periodization of seven ages, with the last 1,000 years an interim earthly kingdom. Combining the creation week with a day equals 1,000 years, Irenaeus says, for the day of the Lord is as 1,000 years, and in 6 days created things were completed. It is evident, therefore, that they will come to an end at the 6,000 year. And then, quoting Luke 14, verses 12 and 13 about the resurrection of the just, in Matthew 19, verse 29, shall receive in this world 100-fold, he adds, these things belong to the times of the kingdom, which is the seventh day, which was sanctified when God rested from all the works he made, and is the true Sabbath of the righteous. At the Lord's coming, the righteous will be resurrected and will reign on earth, according to Irenaeus. The renovated creation will produce all kinds of food in abundance, and Jerusalem will be rebuilt, a typical millennial scheme. The purpose of this millennial kingdom, however, is distinctively stated by Irenaeus. He says that it will be the beginning of incorruption. It will be so that those who are worthy are accustomed little by little to apprehend God. And growing as a result of the vision of the Lord, they shall become accustomed to apprehend the glory of God the Father. And in the kingdom they shall obtain spiritual conversation, communion, and unity with the holy angels. This in preparation for the heavenly kingdom. Irenaeus is aware of those reckoned as orthodox who do not know what he regards as the correct sequence for the exaltation of the righteous and are ignorant of the methods for training in incorruption and ignorant of the dispensations of God. Irenaeus is thus the first in Christian literature to have expressly 7,000 years, 6,000 plus the millennial kingdom, followed by eternity. Lactantius in the late 3rd and early 4th century was another who followed this line of thought. In contrast to philosophers who count thousands of ages from the beginning of the world, he declared that the consummation will come in the 6,000th year. Since all the works of God were completed in 6 days, the world must continue in its present state through 6 ages, that is 6,000 years. But 7 is the complete number, and he refers to the Hebrew Sabbath, which word he wrongly says meant 7. It actually comes from a root meaning rest or repose. but he refers to the Hebrew Sabbath, to 7 days of the week, and to the seven planets known to Hellenistic science. Therefore, since God rested on the seventh day and blessed it, at the end of the 6,000th year, all wickedness must be abolished from the earth and righteousness reign for 1,000 years. On the other hand, however, not all who spoke of seven ages were millennialists. Clement of Alexandria, referring to the 7 days of the creation week, the seven heavens, above which is the eighth heaven, and 7 days preceding sacrifices for sins, mentions seven periods that return to the chief rest. He may be referring to the Jubilee year, or he may be alluding to his combining of the seventh day rest with the eschatological eighth day. Either way, his main concern here is not chronology, but seven as the state of repose. Cyprian was another non-Kiliist who accepted that 6,000 years are now nearly completed since the devil first attacked humanity. But the devil will be conquered because Christ, whom that person who is attacked confesses, is unconquered. Basil of Caesarea in Cappadocia continued the non-millennial line of the Greek church, but instead of identifying 7 and 8, as Barnabas and Clement of Alexandria did, he identified the numbers 1 and 8, the state which follows after this present time, the day which knows no decline or eventide, and no successors, that age which does not end and does not grow old. Hilary of Poitiers, a Latin writer in the 4th century, continued the interpretation of the 6 days of creation as indicating 6,000 years for the span of the world, citing Psalms 90, verse 4, followed by the end of the ages and rest without a millennium. He interpreted the 6 days of Israelites marching around Jericho, Joshua 6, as a type of this world that lasts for 6,000 years. In the seventh millennium, this world is destroyed at the sound of the trumpet. The church alone is saved because it has confessed the incarnation of God and because Jesus has given the sign of the scarlet thread. It remained for Augustine of Hippo in North Africa in the late 4th and early 5th century to divide the 6,000 and 7,000 years into specific eras of human history. The first age of human history was from Adam to the flood. The second age was from Noah to Abraham. Augustine correlated the next three ages with the 14 generations each in Matthew's genealogy of Jesus. So the third age was from Abraham to David, the fourth from David to the Babylonian captivity, and the fifth from the captivity to the coming of Christ. The sixth period is the present age. The Sabbath age arrives with the second coming of Christ and is brought to a close by the eighth or eternal day. In another work, Augustine also saw in the number 7 the ages of human life. The periods of history correspond to the 7 ages of a human being. From Adam to Noah is infancy. From Noah to Abraham is childhood. Abraham to David is adolescence. From David to the exile is youth. From the exile to the coming of Christ is the period between a younger man and an older man. And the time between the comings of Christ is an old man. This is followed by rest with Christ. And he follows in this work by seeing in the 7 periods also the stages of spiritual development of an individual. Augustine acknowledged that he once held a Kiliastic view, but in his mature thought he offered 2 interpretations of the 1,000 years of Revelation 20. One interpretation was that the things described in that chapter will happen during the 6th millennium of the world's history, the author calling the last part of the period by the designation for the whole of the period. Or a second interpretation, the 1,000 years is symbolic of the whole duration of this world. He continues by suggesting that the saints reign with Christ now, for the church is the kingdom of Christ, who rules over the faithful, living and dead. Augustine bequeathed the seven ages of human history and of an individual human life to the West. The latter, that is, the seven ages of human life, are best known in English literature from Shakespeare. In Jacques's speech in As You Like It, all the world's a stage and all the men and women merely players, the seven periods of life are pessimistically portrayed as a puking infant, a whining schoolboy, a sighing lover, a soldier quick in quarrel, a wise justice, bespectacled old age, and finally second childhood without teeth, eyes, and taste. I'm rapidly approaching that. In addition to the seven ages without the millennium, Augustine also employed a division into four ages. Both schemes were understood as different aspects of the one history of salvation. Four periods of human history, sometimes modified as five, was also common in early Christian writers, although there is not agreement in identifying what these eras were. A division into four or five ages had Greek and Roman precedents. Ancient Greece had known four periods of the history of the world. This was given classical statement in Hesiod, the golden, silver, bronze, and iron ages. But he broke it up by putting the race of the demigods between the third and fourth ages, so giving in effect five ages. The Sibylline oracles had four kingdoms: Assyria, the Medes, Persians, and Macedonians, followed by the rise of Rome and the destruction of Jerusalem, again four becoming five. These kingdoms differ from Daniel 2 and 7, where the first empire is Babylon. In another passage in the Sibylline Oracles, eight kingdoms are mentioned: Egypt, Persians, the Medes, Ethiopians, Assyrian Babylon, Macedonians, Egypt again, and Rome. If a preceding kingdom of Kronos and an anticipated end-time kingdom are added, the list would be brought to 10. Christian authors, however, do not develop a tenfold periodization. A division into four ages is reflected in early Christian authors. Hermas, one of the apostolic fathers in the early second century, has four stages in the building of the tower, which stands for the church. The first 10 stones, which were placed as the foundation, are the first generation, but the 25 stones are the second generation of upright men. The 35 are the prophets and ministers of God, and the 40 are the apostles and teachers who proclaim the Son of God. This description may imply historical epochs, but if so, they are not clearly delineated, nor is the idea developed. Returning to Irenaeus, we find in him also a biblical periodization in the four steps in the history of salvation. He stated there are four general covenants given to human beings. There is a textual problem in what follows. The early Latin translation of Irenaeus and the later quotations from him in Greek differ on what these four covenants were. According to the Latin, one covenant was before the flood under Adam, the second then after the flood under Noah, the third the law under Moses, and the fourth then that which renews humanity and sums up all things in itself by means of the gospel. According to the Greek, one covenant was from the flood of Noah with the rainbow, the second was from Abraham with the sign of circumcision, the third was the giving of the law by Moses, the fourth was the covenant of the gospel through our Lord Jesus Christ. The Greek has in its favor that the Bible uses the word covenant in connection with the four named covenants. And irony is his demonstration of the apostolic preaching uses covenant of nearly the same four stages in the history of salvation. Noah, Abraham, David, and Jeremiah's prophecy of a new covenant. The Latin version, however, approximates Paul's division of religious history according to natural law, Mosaic law, grace, and glory. Without spelling out the period so explicitly, Justin Martyr had already implied a fourfold periodization: before the law, under the law, under Christ, and the millennium at Christ's second coming. In his polemic against Judaism, Justin appealed to those who were righteous before the giving of the law of Moses. The following passage delineates different stages in God's institutions. As then circumcision began from Abraham, and the Sabbath and sacrifices and offerings and feasts from Moses, and it has been proved that they were enjoined on account of the hardness of your people's, he's referring to the Jews, the hardness of your people's heart, so it was necessary in accordance with the Father's will that they should cease in Christ the Son of God, who was proclaimed to all the world as about to come as the eternal law and the new covenant. Elsewhere, Justin added to the three periods of this passage a millennium after the resurrection of the righteous. There will be a resurrection of the flesh, and 1,000 years in Jerusalem, which will be rebuilt, adorned, and enlarged, as the prophets acknowledge. There was a certain man among us named John, one of the apostles of Christ, who prophesied in the revelation that came to him that those who believe in our Christ will have 1,000 years in Jerusalem. After this, there will be the general and, to summarize, eternal resurrection of all together and the judgment. Even as we saw periodizations into 6 or 7 ages were related, it seems that the 4 ages could morph into 5. Irenaeus' interpretation of the parable of the workers in the vineyard, Matthew 20, noted the 5 periods of time at which the workers were called. But this is incidental to his point about the Lord teaching one and the same Father. One and the same God is declared as having called some in the beginning, when the world was first created, but others afterwards, and others during the intermediate period, others after a long lapse of time, and others again in the end of time, so that there are many workmen in their generations, but only one householder who calls them together. Similar to Irenaeus and Paul, Clement of Alexandria periodized history as before the law, those who lived rightly before the law, under the law, and under Christ. He speaks of covenants associated with 5 persons: Adam, Noah, Abraham, Moses, and by implication, Christ. He continues with a threefold classification by speaking of holy men before the law as the patriarchs, and Moses and the prophets, and then also the apostles. Origen's allegorical interpretation of the workers in the vineyard combines Irenaeus' time periods and Clement's listing of covenants. We inquire how the householder deliberately assigned to 5 orders of workmen work in his vineyard. See, if you're able, the first order to refer to that pertaining to Adam at the creation of the world, the second order to that pertaining to Noah and the covenant with him, and the third to that pertaining to Abraham, with whom are included by implication the affairs of the fathers up to Moses, the fourth to that pertaining to Moses and all the dispensation of Egypt and the giving of the law in the wilderness. The last order is that pertaining to the coming of Christ Jesus. Methodius gave an allegory of the trees demanding a king in Judges 9, verses 8 through 15, as signifying 4 dispensations. The fig tree represented paradise, the vine represented Noah at the time of the flood, the olive represented the law given to Moses, and the bramble represented the law which was given to the apostles for the salvation of the world. Eusebius set the framework for his church history by sketching in a verbose manner primitive wickedness, the worship of God instituted by Moses, and finally, at the time of the Roman Empire, the appearance of the divine and heavenly Word of God. Similarly, Eusebius began his proof of the gospel by explaining that in his work on the preparation of the gospel, he had shown that Christianity was neither a form of Hellenism nor of Judaism, but that the new covenant brought by the Savior Jesus Christ was the restoration of the ancient and original natural religion. Hilary of Poitiers, again, in his commentary on Matthew 14, verse 25, the fourth watch of the night, explained that the first watch was the law, the second the prophets, the third the Lord's bodily advent, and the fourth, in which Jesus appeared to the disciples in the boat, will be his glorious return. He continued the tradition of identifying the five times at which workmen were hired for the vineyard in Matthew 20 with eras of biblical history. The first hour was the covenant with Noah. The third hour was the covenant with Abraham. The sixth hour, the covenant with Moses. The ninth hour, the time of David and the prophets. And the 11th hour represents the advent of the Lord. Ambrose of Milan, who lived from 339 to 397, correlated the four rivers of paradise in Genesis 2 with the four cardinal virtues of Greek and Latin ethics and with four great ages of the world. The first is the age of wisdom from the beginning to the flood. The second age is that of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and the patriarchs when religion flourished in a pure form, temperance. The third age is the period of the law of Moses with men of fortitude or courage. And the fourth age is that of justice with the salvation by the Lord. God himself is the source of all other virtues. The superiority of what Christ brought excels all that came before him. Thus you have some examples of the imaginative scriptural interpretation that the early church fathers employed. It's a non-literal interpretation, but it has a spiritual message and is intended for the edification of people. Well, as 6 and 7 and 4 and 5 came together, so 2 and 3 ages came together. By omitting a division at the flood or with Abraham, we get three periods before the law, under the law, and under Christ before heavenly glory. And that is familiar to us as the three dispensations of biblical history: patriarchal, Mosaic, and Christian. This analysis points to the most common division of time employed by early Christian writers. The most frequent scheme in the early history of the church, prompted as it was by the interpretation of Scripture, was twofold: Old Covenant and New Covenant, before and after Christ, sometimes modified by the recognition of an earlier third period before the giving of the Mosaic Covenant. Although Luneau gives some of the relevant information for the formulation of two eras, he does not develop the idea because he was interested primarily in the fourfold and sevenfold periodizations. This division into two eras, by its frequency, would seem to be more fundamental than the other periodizations. And this, too, is characteristic of biblical interpretation in churches of Christ. This periodization in two eras is commonly expressed in terms of two covenants: the old with Israel, delivered by Moses, and the new for all nations through Jesus Christ. Justin Martyr read in his Bible, quote, that there shall be a final law and a covenant, the best of all. He continued, For the law given on Horeb is already old and is yours, he's referring to the Jews, is yours alone. But this one is for all universally. Now law placed against law has put an end to that which is before it, and a covenant which comes after in like manner has annulled the previous one. And an eternal and final law, namely Christ, has been given to us, and his covenant is trustworthy. Because of his polemic against the Jews, Justin makes more frequent reference to the Old and New Covenants than to his fourfold periodization that we had noted earlier. Justin implies a twofold periodization in reference to pagans as well as to Jews. Our Christian doctrines appear to be greater than all human teaching, because Christ, who appeared for our sakes, became the whole rational being, both body, reason, and soul. For whatever either lawgivers or philosophers uttered well, they elaborated by finding and contemplating some part of the Word, capital W. But since they did not know the whole of the Word, capital W, which is Christ, they often contradicted themselves. Or again, Justin says, for each, he's referring to philosophers, poets, and historians, spoke well in proportion to the share he had of the word sowed among mankind. Whatever things were rightly said among all men are the property of us Christians. For all the writers were able to see realities darkly through the sowing of the implanted word that was in them. For the seed and imitation imparted according to capacity is one thing, and quite another is the thing itself. So for Justin, what was before Christ was partial and imitative. Christ brought completeness and healing to the human race. Irenaeus, too, more commonly took over Paul's language in 2 Corinthians 3 of old and new covenants. He interpreted Matthew 13, verse 52, the householder who brings out of his treasure things old and new, as referring to two covenants. The old would be that previous giving of the law, and the new points out that manner of life according to the gospel. For Irenaeus, there was an old covenant for Jews and a new covenant for all. The law replaced by the gospel of liberty, the different covenants suited to the stages of human maturity, and the whole sequence presided over by one God. You may think that I'm like a windmill, although instead of producing water, the water produces the wind. For Irenaeus, the two covenants were foreshadowed in Abraham. Abraham was the source of circumcision and the law of works during the intermediate time, but he was also the forerunner of Christian faith, having received justification by faith before receiving circumcision. Irenaeus affirmed that all the apostles taught that there were two covenants for the two peoples, but one and the same God who ordered both for the good of those to whom the covenants were given. The coming of Christ, who fulfilled the new covenant predicted by the law, was the decisive turning point between the ages. Although Tertullian presented the ideas of a general and primordial unwritten law from Adam to Moses, and then Moses' law is temporary, as shown by prophecies of a new covenant and new law, he often also wrote of two dispensations, or two testaments. Marcion's emphasis on the diversity of the law in the gospel is overturned, because the Creator himself had promised a new law and a new word and a new testament. Tertullian uses Old Scriptures and New Testament as titles of books, the latter containing gospels and writings of the apostles. This usage was already present in Clement of Alexandria. After declaring that God himself promulgated the scriptures by his son, he says that the knowledge of God is preached and spoken by the old and new covenant. Clement's threefold source of authority, the prophets, the gospel, and the blessed apostles, centered in the Lord, who in bringing a new covenant made what had preceded it old. God made a new covenant with us, for what belonged to the Greeks and Jews is old. Formerly, the older people had an old covenant, and the law disciplined the people with fear. But to the fresh and new people has also been given a new covenant. Cyprian made explicit reference to Paul's division of time. Judgment will be according to the times, either according to equity before the giving of the law, or according to the law of Moses, followed by a quotation of Romans 2, verse 12. The periodization of history in terms of the two covenants, marking in effect three ages, continued in later authors. In the 4th century, Gregory of Nazianzus has this striking imagery. There have been in the whole period of the duration of the world two conspicuous changes of human lives, which are also called two testaments, or on account of the wide fame of the matter, two earthquakes, one from idols to the law, and the other from the law to the gospel. And we are taught in the gospel of a third earthquake, namely from this earth to that which cannot be shaken or moved. Gregory is referring here to the earthquake in Exodus 19, verse 18, that accompanied the giving of the law of Mount Sinai, and to the earthquake at the time of the crucifixion of Jesus, Matthew 27, verse 51, and then to the final shaking of the world that Hebrews 12, verse 26 speaks of. Without expressly speaking of two eras, Hilary of Poitiers pointed out the significance of Christ that made this distinction important. For him, everything in the holy books, announced by words, revealed in facts, and established by examples, the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. He declared that from Adam through the prophets, each person, each epoch, and each fact projected as in a mirror the image of Christ's advent, preaching, passion, resurrection, and church. Jerome gave strong affirmation of the difference Christ made. Every dispensation that has existed in the world, both before and after it, comprising invisible as well as visible creatures, has promised the advent of the Son of God. He mentions Adam, the Tower of Babel, Isaac, and Samson. He continues, all the mysteries and every ancient dispensation that have not only occurred on earth but also in heaven have been completed in the passion of Christ. For when once Christ died for me, then buried, resurrected, and ascended to the Father as victor, I have no need of what was old. Cyril of Alexandria continued in the Greek East a sharp distinction between the age of Moses and the prophets and the age of Christ, who is the end of the law and prophets. This division into two eras was a distinctively Christian periodization. Neither paganism nor Judaism has such a game changer as the one-time incarnation of the Son of God. The coming of Christ was the dividing mark, a division given calendrical codification by Dionysius Exiguus in the 6th century and perpetuated in the dating system B.C. before Christ and A.D. Anno Domini in the year of the Lord. This system of dating prevailed in the Western world for 14 centuries, now often replaced in certain circles by BCE, before the Common Era, and CE, the Common Era, because many now do not acknowledge Jesus as the Christ or Lord. But the new designation still represents the same reality. You will notice that several of these authors employ two or more of the schemes we have analyzed. What was used depended on whether the concern was with world chronology, the interpretation of a passage of Scripture, the biblical covenants, or the uniqueness and importance of Christ. That is, their main interest was not historiographical. Rather, it was what God has done and will do. Yet history is the framework in which these events occurred. For early Christians, whatever the schemes employed, the ages of the world climaxed in the age of the church, itself a foretaste of eschatological consummation. And so, however much the historical awareness, there was a greater interest in the present and the future than in the past.
We have time to take a few questions if anyone would like to ask some.
I was amazed that none of those guys referred to Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration when Moses and Elijah appeared with Jesus there. I mean, that would have been a good place to show the two covenant theory.
Well, that does not show up in the passages I selected.
So you're saying some...
I'm not sure that they didn't do that sometime. Uh-huh. Good observation, though.
What period of time do you put the writing of the Book of Barnabas in your studies?
Oh, it has been dated by scholars any time from about 70 to about 135. Uh-huh. And you can make a case for either two or three options in there. I tend to apply it more to the latter end of that time period, but it's uncertain.
So you're familiar with Charles Biggs' Origin of Christianity, then, where he devotes a whole chapter to Barnabas.
Yeah.
You brought up Augustine of Hippo, and you talked about how he had affected us. Would you say he's the thought of us doing our periodizations? You say that he's the largest, one of the largest figures?
He certainly has had a tremendous influence on all of Western Christianity, right through the Middle Ages, and even the Reformers were very much indebted to Augustine.
Yeah.
And that the influence of his thought continues then on to today. Yes.
You had said that the majority of the early fathers talked about the two or maybe the three dispensations or eras. If you had to give some percentages off the top of your head or maybe think about, I know that's an unfair question, maybe, you know, how much more weight was given to those than to the four?
Well, in terms of the number of times that it's employed, mm-hmm. Maybe half of the references
are
to do with the twofold separation.
Mm-hmm.
But you could also say that that implies three, because there was that period before the Old Covenant. Yes.
Did any of the fathers ever argue between themselves and say, now so-and-so said this, but he was really wrong, and they called him out, and that kind of thing?
they did that about the millennium. And on other questions, too. Although it is notable that the millennium was not the occasion of breaking of fellowship.
That was my next question. Did any of these divisions become fellowship issues?
That disagreement about eschatology was not something that was a factor in divisions in the ancient church.
What about Eusebius referring to John in the bathhouse in Ephesus fleeing when Cerinthius comes in? And I find that Cerinthius was one of the people who was teaching a millennium.
Yes, and there's a problem about that, because there's another version of Cerinthius' teaching that would be completely opposite to mm-hmm. that. I suspect that Cerinthus was actually more like Marcion, and that this
attribution to him of a millennium is his saying that according to the Jewish interpretation of the Old Testament, that is what would follow. But I don't know. He could be an early representative of millennial thought. You know, good to have someone here knowledgeable about these sources. Keeps me honest. I thought surely someone was going to pick up on my concluding comment. How can a historian make the statement that I did? The early church was more interested in the present and the future than it was the past. But I would put in a plea for knowing the past, but I think for us too that the same is true. We're more interested in the present and hopefully in the future. Although another observation that I've made coming out of my historical studies is that a major difference between the early church and us today is that they had a much stronger expectation of the coming of Christ than I think is characteristic of us. I guess 2,000 years have deadened our sensitivity.
That's what I was going to ask you. Do you think that time has that's transpired has dumbed our senses down to that?
I'm sure that's a major factor.
Because in Paul's day, boy, they thought he was just coming right back then.
Let's give Everett another hand.